Well, good morning. It is fantastic to be with you this morning. We finished our Ghost series just last week, and before we sort of jump on into our next series, which is going to begin next week, we thought that it would be really good for us just to take a moment and just have a Sunday where we kind of think a little bit about our vision. We launched this year with our big three, and there's kind of talking in threes about sort of challenges and areas that we're looking to move into, particularly this year. So here we are. We're back for this Sunday. Bobby's with me in my living room, and we're here to talk a little bit about vision, Bobby.
This is always good. Hey, great job on the marriage announcement. Love that.
You think so? I don't feel like people were with me on the marriage announcement.
You know, it's always a challenge because they're actually really with you, but there's a lot of smart people that haven't figured out. I learned something from a great couple here. They just said one of the tips, and so if for whatever reason you're booked, you can't make it that weekend, this is a really good one. You just once a week, every man yell into the living room, the kitchen, wherever your wife is, and just say, "I'm sorry. I was wrong." You don't even have to know what it was for. Every week, if you do that, it's amazing. It just solves all these problems. Hey, and I want to say, nice job on the water. In the olden days, didn't we go to wells to get this?
Well, this is true, but now we have smart water. I don't know what makes this water smart.
We're going to find out today.
But speaking of water, let's read the Bible, huh? In John chapter 4, you see nice. That set? I feel like they're onto us, you know, like... They felt our setup.
The other crowd didn't get it. They thought we were amazing. Smart water.
So now this is Jesus, had to go through Samaria. This is John chapter 4 and verse 4. So he came to a town in Samaria called Sychar, near the plot of ground Jacob had given to his son Joseph. Jacob's well was there. And Jesus, tired as he was from the journey, sat down by the well. It was about noon. When a Samaritan woman came to draw water, Jesus said to her, "Will you give me a drink?" His disciples had gone into the town to buy food. The Samaritan woman said to him, "You are a Jew and I am a Samaritan woman. How can you ask me for a drink? For Jews do not associate with Samaritans." Jesus answered her, "If you knew the gift of God and who it is that asks you for a drink, you would have asked him and he would have given you living water." "Sir," the woman said, "you have nothing to draw with and the well is deep. Where can you get this living water? Are you greater than our father Jacob, who gave us the well and drank from it himself, as did also his sons and his livestock?" Jesus answered, "Everyone who drinks this water will be thirsty again, but whoever drinks the water I give them will never thirst. Indeed, the water I give them will become in them a spring of water welling up to eternal life." The woman said to him, "Sir, give me this water so that I won't get thirsty and have to keep coming here to draw water." He told her, "Go, call your husband and come back." "I have no husband," she replied. Jesus said to her, "You are right when you say you have no husband. The fact is, you have had five husbands, and the man you now have is not your husband. What you have just said is quite true." "Sir," the woman said, "I can see that you are a prophet. Our ancestors worshipped on this mountain, but you Jews claim that the place where we must worship is in Jerusalem." I love this, by the way. Conversation gets a little edgy, a little kind of close to the bone. Let's just bring in a theological discussion and change the subject completely. This is a good strategy. "Woman," Jesus replied, "believe me, a time is coming when you will worship the Father neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem. You Samaritans worship what you do not know. We worship what we do know, for salvation is from the Jews. Yet a time is coming and has now come when the true worshipers will worship the Father in the Spirit and in truth, for they are the kind of worshipers the Father seeks. God is Spirit, and his worshipers must worship in the Spirit and in truth." The woman said, "I know that Messiah, called Christ, is coming, and when he comes, he will explain everything to us." Then Jesus declared, "I, the one speaking to you, I am he." Just then his disciples returned and were surprised to find him talking with a woman. But no one asked, "What do you want?" or "Why are you talking with her?" And then, leaving her water jar, the woman went back to the town and said to the people, "Come, see a man who told me everything I ever did. Could this be the Messiah?" And they came out of the town and made their way toward him. We've been talking a little bit about this story over the last few months, you and I, and we've been talking about it in a variety of contexts behind the scenes at Westside. And you, there's a lot to unpack. I mean, this story's got so much richness in it. But there's one thing you keep asking, you and I in our one-to-one conversations, whether we're just sat, you know, having a coffee somewhere or whether we're in a kind of, you know, more formal meeting. I notice you keep asking this same question here about are we people of the well? Do you want to unpack that for us a little bit? Why is it that this sort of really has got into your heart?
David, I think that as we progress into a real place of wholeness as a church, we're starting to understand what God is asking of all of us. And in fact, the unique part about this story is this isn't something we've gone looking for. Mm-hmm. The story is being unpacked in the middle of us. It's happening too much to not identify it. And so it's really moving itself to what I would say a place of value. It's a new value that we are going to be bringing. We'll be talking about that later on in this year. The reason why I think it's so relevant for us is each person here, all of us today, we come with our own backdrop of our own storyline from church world. That might be a couple of weeks, that might be a few months, that might be like myself, born and raised in church world. And when you look at that journey, it plays a bit of role to understand text and how that fits and how the story is. And as we read and learn, it brings direction to us. One of the complications for me growing up in church, born in church, faith came there, grandparents, parents. And it wasn't until in my later years, I was a youth helper, then a youth leader, and then felt the direction to go to Bible college. But before that, I went into what I call the workforce, the real world. And the real world for 7 years, and it made me realize the disconnect between church and real issues, real people. The problem was is that in my era, and I can only speak to mine, is there was no entrance. There was a great entrance point to church, but no exit. And so the problem is we had people coming in, and then we held on to them, but there wasn't what I call the U-turn, where you come in, you learn, you go back into your role or your job or your setting. Yeah. And it made this disconnect, howbeit for great reasons and great communities and learning faith. And we left these connection points that God had for us. So when we look at this story, it's incredible, all of the parts that we unpack, because we have to be people of the well. And what we're seeing is, when we think about this idea of well, is that there's these unique storylines that we didn't imagine happening tomorrow, Tuesday, later tonight, this afternoon. They're just moments where we didn't understand how we got here. And there's challenges around that. There's fear of what would I say? What do I do? I wasn't expecting. It's really the pastor's job. There's all of these parts to it. But Jesus gives us an incredible story to look at and then pull it apart. And you do that so well to help us understand. So I just believe we are always to be people of the well. We have church. Church is a big part for us. It's how we learn, we develop, we grow. Yeah. But these well moments that we are caught up in a storyline of people's struggle, complication, challenges, successes, God plants us as believers right in the middle of that.
It strikes me that, like, again, and I think you and I, when we share stories as we've got to know each other over the last few years, there's a similarity, I think, in some of the journeys that we've walked together in our church experience. It feels to me sometimes like we were pretty good at figuring out how to be Jesus' people on Sunday morning and pretty terrible at figuring out how to be Jesus' people the rest of the time. And this well kind of story, to me, locates us somewhere. So, you know, again, perhaps sometimes our tradition is, well, you know, hey, we've got this living water of Jesus, and if you can figure out how to get to us, we'll share it with you. But here Jesus is. He's in Samaria. He's out of his own normal context. And this speaks to something that I hear you constantly talk about, and I feel like it's a kind of rhythm of your heart at some level, where perhaps put the phrase like this, everyday people everywhere. You know. So in one sense, this story is kind of surprising, and John, as he tells it, is kind of leaning into some of the surprise. But actually, the story is really, really normal. You know, Jesus is at this well because he's thirsty. And Jesus is thirsty, well, because it's hot and he's tired. And the woman, she's at the well because, you know, a lot of people gossiping about her, more than likely. She's kind of a social outcast at some level. So this is just a safe time. Like, there's nothing miraculous or profound about what they're doing. You know, it's not like sometimes we tell stories about Jesus, and Jesus, let's be honest, he comes over a little creepy, you know, like just hanging out at the well. you know. Do you know what I mean? Just waiting for someone to turn up. And there he is, you know, with his white robe and his blow-dried hair. You know, like in those kind of real creepy Jesus movies that you see. And then John seems to be going out of his way to say, this is like a really normal situation for really normal reasons. Thirsty someone, two thirsty people find themselves at a place where you can get water. And you talk a lot about this sort of the everydayness of our interactions with people.
Yeah, I think there's the everyday part that we just happen to be, whatever our life is. Sometimes it's a work moment. Sometimes it's a connection there. Sometimes it's just in our ebb and flow of life. Sometimes it's through our kids. There's this connection point. The part for me that I've found over the last year is I feel like God keeps putting me in really strange settings that I completely am not prepared for.
Right.
And I kind of like it because when it's over, it makes sense to me, but in the moment, I'm not getting why I'm here. And we had it a couple of weeks ago. Like I said, it's just happening too much now to not recognize it. And we just were invited to a non-Westside church connection that we've made over the last couple of years. And it was a doctor. Like, I don't spend a lot of time with doctors. It's not my spot. I don't spend a lot of time with doctors. It's...
I didn't know whether to make the comment or not.
Well, if you had some smart water. So here we are at a dinner, you know, and it was after we were invited to a wedding a year ago, and now we're at a 50th party, and you know, you're trying to navigate, you know, where you're going to sit, and I don't really know them, and I think I remember them from, and so I sat down, and I'm in this moment, and I really liked this guy beside me. He was kind of a lot of fun at the wedding, but it was a light connection. I was trying to talk them into getting married. It was quite hilarious. So here we are again. And he turns to me and said, oh, you're not going to believe it. I just got another bottle of scotch for my collection. I'm thinking, scotch collection, scotch tape, scotch. And then I get it. And then he opens up his phone and he gives me a video of the special room he's built and his 100 bottles. What do you do with 100 bottles of scotch?
You asking that question to a Scotsman?
Yeah, you're right. Sorry, wrong. I can have a little more smart water. And as I'm having conversation with him, I'm going, you don't know what you're talking about. You don't know anything about this topic. And I'm trying to think of malts and singles, and I don't know. And I'm thinking, oh, here I am. Why don't we talk about something I know, and I'm not there? And then another conversation, another part of the conversation, then he talks to me about his mother. And then he says, my mother, I said, how is she doing? He goes, well, it's been quite a journey. She attempted suicide a couple of years ago and failed. How we start at scotch and get to mother. And now I'm in. Now I'm in an area that I can converse. And we talked about the journey of her soul and depression, and I tied it to the series that we've been walking through. Now I'm equipped, and now I'm in an intimate detail of walking through a part of his own life with his mom. And you look back and say, I get it now. Second conversation, third conversation, but a well experience. And I just see how God keeps putting us in these moments that we don't understand, but here we are, and we represent Jesus at the well.
And that's, and you mentioned this, and I use this phrase, you know, the step into awkward. So there's the everyday conversation, like I'm at a party, it's a really normal thing to have happen. You know, Jesus is by a well, it's a really normal thing to have happen. And that can be just an interacting moment where it's like, hey, okay, so you're into scotch, that's lovely, and we go our separate ways. But sometimes if there's a willingness just to breathe in that awkward moment of, you know, socioeconomically, perhaps we're not in the same place, you know, interest-wise, perhaps we're not in the same place. You know, Jesus is managing, you know, a racial divide, it's a Jew and a Samaritan, he's managing a gender divide, it's a man and a woman there, and, you know, and he's managing, actually, there's a real barrier there. You see it when he starts to approach the conversation about this lady's relationship. She kind of backs away, gets a little bit awkward, tries to change the subject a little bit. There's these moments where if we're willing to almost just live in a little bit of, not weird, but awkward, you know, sometimes the conversations can really blossom into some really fascinating spaces, can't they?
Well, it feels to me that when we're in a moment that we don't have all the answers in, I just feel like God shows up there. I feel like when we're in it with all this confidence and we can figure it out, certainly there's comfort in that, but there's something in that awkward needing to rely on God. You know, part of it in the story, and you do such a great job of this, when you unpack things, we start to learn more. So we learn about the complications of the timing of there. And I think part of this whole awkward piece is if we were to look at our calendar as smart Calgarians and doing the life that we do, and we said, okay, I kind of get it. They're gonna, you know, our people this morning listened to us, said, okay, right, I need to schedule more time for these well moments. The problem is, I don't know that it really works that way. You know, this Thursday from 2 to 3, I have a moment that I'm going to wait, and God's going to bring someone into my calendar, and we're going to have it. Yeah. The problem is that'll happen. Yeah.
Well, that's creepy Jesus hanging out by the well again, if you're not careful, isn't it?
Creepy Jesus at the well doesn't work. All of a sudden, there's an urgent moment, or there's a challenging, or we have someone else waiting, but then this conversation starts to turn. And you can recognize it, and it's recognizing it that here I am. I'm in one of those moments. Sometimes it's a lineup. Sometimes you're just waiting. Sometimes it's just saying something incredibly positive or uplifting to someone in a Starbucks or a moment together. And all of a sudden, it just starts to shape. Yeah. And that's where we have to be prepared of what the, you know, for me, it's difficult because one of the challenges that we face is in ministry, people just assume it's our job. You know, if you're an extrovert, you're really in trouble because that's what weird extroverts do. They just talk to everybody, but that's kind of strange. You know, and if you're a pastor, well, you're supposed to. I mean, you look around the room, you've got 21 people, pastor, he prays. Yeah. You know, I feel bad because when people come to our house, they look at me like I'm supposed to be the prayer person. Like where, it wasn't in our training, but there's just this expectation that all of a sudden you're at dinner and, well, Bobby would pray. Well, actually, I'm the worst. If you want a good prayer at our house, you got to go to Farah. I mean, she's just been praying storms lately. It's just beautiful. I mean, you guys roll over and she's praying. Where is this coming from? Like, I want pray for me. She's that good. Yeah. So we can't just assume that because it's our role. There's these moments that we can't miss, but we have to be able to walk in the challenge of the interruption of the moment of our own life. Yeah. And we feel that, oh, man, here I am. It's uncomfortable. This isn't what I planned. I didn't see this coming, and here we are. I was giving away a mirror. We changed in our house with this big mirror, and I just wanted to get rid of it, and I couldn't throw it out because it was too good. So I put it on Kijiji for free. Wow! Like within minutes, 19 people need this mirror. And this, I mean, it was just, I wouldn't recommend it because it was just like, you know, so this girl shows up next day. I held it for her overnight. And we carried out and get in a car. And she said, I just want to say thank you for holding it for me. And it's all in and got it all leveled. And I said, well, you know, there's a catch. She goes, what's the catch? I said, you got to come to church. It's Christmas Eve. And of course, I was in my painting clothes. She says, I did not see that coming. So my new thing is give it away, provide these moments, and even leverage a few if you can with a mirror.
I've noticed that's your new thing. I really enjoyed sitting on the floor at your house the other day there because you gave away the table and the chairs but lovely to have you all with us. I wonder about this in terms of that question. So where are the wells? You know, like we tell the stories, of beautiful moments of interaction with people. But I also feel like I probably miss tons of them. You know, conversations that I'm driving away from thinking, do you know what, there was probably an opening in that conversation just to hang around a little bit and have a little more conversation, open up an opportunity to talk to somebody a little bit more. And I know you say this a lot of time, like for us as a team, you're encouraging us, because let's be totally frank, it's easy actually as a pastor to kind of spend your whole time around your church people that you're paid to look after, the vision that you're trying to drive. And, you know, and so you're always encouraging us as a team to like find healthy places of life just to go and be yourself. Because actually it's good to live in those sort of spaces, but also that's where gospel does its best kind of breathing and work. And there's probably for a lot of us, there's a reality that life just kind of gets busy and it's easy to miss these moments and not think, are these moments well? Would you think that's a fair thing to say?
And you know, you followed through with that in your running career and the way that's been an awesome thing for you. And in fact, Christmas was kind of quite hilarious. I met three of David's running friends, and as David introduced them to me on one of our services, they all said the same thing. We're not here for church. We're not here for nativity, Jesus. We're not here for that. We just want to see if he's any good because he talks a good game. And I thought... Wow, right out in the open, here we are. And it was awesome. But I know the relationships being, you're not there as the bait and switch. And oftentimes in church world, that's the part that I find very, 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 very unfair. We have these false friendships.
Yes.
We do false things, or they seem to have a good appearance,
yeah.
But it's the bait and switch. At some point in time, we are leveraged to get them in the door of church rather to say, I just want to walk with you. We don't know what the predictor is at the end,
yes.
But we know through an authentic relationship, I care about you, we're going to learn together. I mean, you're a great support in the group because you're a great runner. You're learning, they're working together. So it isn't just, hanging around waiting. And I think that's an enormous part that we can help people be set free from that have some of that past baggage.
Yeah. And so when we talk about this then, so here, there's three areas particularly that we've been kind of resonating for a while with Westside, but really kind of trying to bring them to the surface in kind of, you know, making them explicit this year. And those would be the sort of three areas, and perhaps we might want to call them in this context, the three places where we feel God's called us to be as people of the well, in areas of evangelism, of areas of discipleship, and also areas of mission. And so let's talk a little bit about them, just these kind of three things. These are our, in some sense, these are Westside's big three, aren't they? Like for me, it's interesting. The word evangelism has some really negative connotations, I find, for a lot of people, because we've encountered either the one extreme, the sort of, you know, like, you know, billboard guy, you know, with his sign, you know, standing shouting at people in the high street, you know, and or then you've got the kind of other side. You've mentioned it a little bit. It's kind of strategic friendship evangelism that I think churches went through a period of really pushing, which just all of it felt very inauthentic. And yet there's this story of Jesus where a very everyday moment, like I'm thirsty, becomes a really significant kingdom conversation. And this is the sort of the divine detour almost, to being open to those interruptions. And particularly what fascinates me about this story is that it becomes a divine detour to someone who is avoided by most people, to somebody who would be quite hard to reach for most people, you know, and yet here Jesus has this incredible conversation. I don't know if you want to say anything about that.
Yeah, the powerful part about the body of Christ is we all have things that we like about each other, and we're all unique, and I don't think that should change. There's people that will be naturally drawn to you. There's people that would naturally be drawn to me, and if we break down the whole group, that's how it works. So we leverage that. We work with who we are, and it's natural for us. And so again, the things that we enjoy, the things that we converse about, the things that we have interest in learning, we leverage that. So it was interesting. A few years ago, for me, it was single-track motocross. I tried to stretch myself in an area, and I spent more time in trees and dirt than I ever imagined. But it was just cool. Just recently,
it sounds terrifying to me whenever you talk about that.
Yeah, well, imagine running. That's even more dangerous. At least
it's quite slow, to be honest with you. It's quite slow. The trees come up very slowly when you're running, you see.
But a bear can't catch me. That's the difference. That's well, unless I fall.
There's a strategy to that. Always run with a slower person.
That's why you keep inviting me.
Well, it's always good. Run with a slower person who's a Christian so you don't carry any guilt if they do get eaten.
Even you know? Better. Well, it's interesting. I had a call recently, and one of the groups I was with, you know, we tried to strategize for the ride, and I was selected to be part of his girlfriend's group, which I thought, wow, she must be amazing. I'm in the top group. Apparently, she had just started to ride, as in the last couple of weeks. So I got quickly moved into the C group, hoping for the B. But she called me just not long ago, last year, and said, hey, I know that you're not riding right now because of your hip, but wondering, would you ever consider doing a wedding in Kukanoosa on the trails? And I said, well, like, absolutely. I don't know if we're going to do the pre-marriage out there, but I don't know how that'll all work. Mm. But here you are. She quickly endorsed in the area that I was in. Mm. So when we have these moments, they're natural, they're authentic, and God is somehow in strategic. And sometimes it's through the kids, sometimes it's through a career, sometimes it's just through an extra conversation, things that we don't understand. But evangelism for me has to have an authentic caring, yeah. I'm in this with you. We aren't the predictors of the end of that journey. We are walking along, which is really what Jesus said when he said, hey, come follow me.
Yeah.
They had no idea what they were getting into, but they knew that they were going to walk together.
I love this this quote from Carl Medearis, who I find is a really fascinating writer on this whole subject of talking about Jesus. And he just says this, like, relax, right, which is a really neat sort of way, you know. Carl says relax. I don't know if that's if that's too bizarre a comment, but enjoy your friends, you know, enjoy their company along with the company of Jesus. Point him out freely without fear or intimidation. You're not responsible to sell him to them. Yeah. You're simply saying what you've seen. You're not the judge. You're the witness. And I think we've done a lot of judging. You know, and that's a kind of complexity that I think the church has got to navigate through. But there's also a piece where, you know, I was in a conversation with a friend just recently, and they asked me a question, and I said it's a difficult question to ask in a contemporary context because I actually know what the politically correct answer is to this question, but the authentic answer you know, and I, without telling you the whole conversation, but I said the authentic answer is for me to talk about my faith and talk about Jesus and how that makes so much sense of this, what we're talking about right now. And it was really interesting to sort of, it struck me that so often, like, I wasn't trying to sell Jesus. I don't think that ever works. I wasn't trying to judge somebody and say, well, you're wrong and I'm right. But it struck me how in our contemporary dialogue, it's sometimes very difficult just to be authentic because people almost expect you to hold a particular line. Whereas that power of saying, hey, let me just share what I have found to be true in my own situation. I think that could be immensely powerful in conversational times.
Yeah, I think it's huge. The second part for me, when we look at our three, so evangelism, discipleship, and mission, when we look at the second, which is discipleship, mm-hmm. it's always been a tough area for me. It's mm-hmm. always been complicated. Because often the area of discipleship is bent in a certain direction. Mm-hmm. And I love to brag about you, and I know you hate it, but I want to say this. The greatest gift that you are to our church, beside the generosity of who you are, the greatest gift you are for us is you can wrestle any text, and I have no fear that we're going to get through this. It doesn't mean it's going to be easy. It doesn't mean that it's not going to help us learn, and that has challenge to it, but we will walk through it. Mm-hmm. Oftentimes in church world, we don't go down certain path because we either don't know how, we don't know what to say, or we're just going to ignore it and hope it mm-hmm. goes away. And you give us a strength to stay in the middle. And I want to say this, I'll share this probably coming up at our community weekend, our leadership weekend. One of the challenges for us today is we need, so if you're gonna leverage relationships, and our church are going to trust us to bring family, friends, those that have been mm-hmm. injured in church, those that said, I'm never trusting again.
Yeah.
When you trust us, it is our responsibility to make sure we don't do wonky Sunday and drive off the ledge in something that makes no sense.
Yeah.
And that's not for just you, that's for me. I'm inviting Heather, I just heard her yesterday talking to Farrah, so who are you bringing out this weekend? Mm. Who are, our kids are doing the same thing. They're living in regular school, regular kids, and inviting all the time. We have a responsibility to stay in the middle, and you do that amazing for us, and we appreciate that.
Well, and like for me, you know, like this conversation with Jesus and this woman, like he balances truth and grace really well in this conversation, like really, really well. But he has that dangerous conversation, but it's a safe, dangerous conversation. And for me, like, the word can be badly used, but the idea of safety and theological safety is profoundly important to me. Like, you know, I've had experience in churches, let me say this, and this is private, it's not like this goes on the internet or anything like that. I've been involved in churches, and I've even been involved at leadership levels in churches that I wouldn't invite my friends to. And that's a shocking sort of thing for me to say about my own ministry, to go, actually, there were places where I just didn't think we were leading well. I wasn't leading well. I don't think we were leading well. And the one thing I wouldn't do is invite my friends to it, you know. And you end up in this kind of complex situation where you go, well, how can we grow this church if I'm not even willing to put my own sort of kind of investment into it? One of the things I say that I really appreciate and love about Westside is, you know, I'm always working, you know, any sermon that I'm doing, I'm aware of the fact I might have friends here, I might have people here that I've invited. And for me, that's profoundly important that we can offer that sense of solidity and trust that says, you know, and I realize that doesn't keep everybody happy all the time. The subjects we teach about, the people say you could have gone further, the subjects that people say, oh, you could have gone further in a different direction. But our aim and sort of constant value is that we navigate a line of truth and grace, and we navigate a line of theological safety. I want anybody ever going home from Westside going, I can't believe I brought my friend today, you know, so that even if it's one of the most awkward conversations, we could still have somebody wander in for the first time and go, okay, I understand how they're putting. For me, that's profoundly important.
Well, you were sharing yesterday, and I know you take the brunt of a lot of emails, so I seem to get all the really beautiful ones, and you get the hard ones.
Yeah, but yeah, what's that about? Like, you know, like,
I think you invited.
Like, I think I'm a nice guy.
I think they're just a lot easier on me because I drink smart water.
Okay.
you said just recently in our last series, it was quite cool. You got a beautiful email from someone. They invited 4 or 5 of their friends from work. Mm-hmm. And I thought, that's exactly what it looks like. A relevant topic mm-hmm. that we cannot not teach. I can't imagine a church that would not be wrestling the whole issue of anxiety, mental illness, depression. But all of a sudden now we hear from someone who we don't know, who is newer to our church, that immediately could invite her friends from work who don't do church.
Yeah.
That's the gift of these well moments.
And it's intentional for us. Like, that is an intentional thing that we, you know, so in one sense, I know we tease about the emails. You know, I appreciate the emails from both sides of perspectives, when we sometimes people don't feel like we've done that well, and when people do feel like we've done that well. For us, that's the constant aim, is that this is a place of theological safety. And you know, that really matters to us. In fact, and on that, there's in the kind of expansion of that. So a couple of things really quickly that are almost just keeping you in the loop of stuff that's going on. You know, we're really excited about our house church network that we're going to get sort of up and running very, very shortly. There's a lot of work going on behind the scenes about that. In fact, next Sunday, after the second service next Sunday at 12:30, we're inviting people that are invested into wanting to help lead in that context to sort of come together, and we're just going to start putting some pieces together for you. I just want to say, if maybe you've not been contacted about that then and wanted to lead in that context, I apologize that we've somehow not been able to reach out to you. Please reach out to us. Maybe that's, hey, I'd love to be invested in that. Or maybe that's, you know what, I'm currently leading a small group and I'd love to bring that as part of this house group network. Then please reach out to us because that's next Sunday that we're doing that. Also, I'm really excited about a weekend that's coming up in March that we're doing. We're calling it Navigating the Future. And we're kind of bringing a few things together into one weekend that we've done in different contexts before. So on Friday evening, where we would normally have our kind of community dinner, you want to say a little bit about what we're doing on Friday evening?
I think it's for everyone, especially to learn a bit more. We call them family meetings at home, but it's that idea, or a town hall meeting where you pull the kids together.
Yeah, and where are we up to?
You know, what are we doing? What are we doing? Why are we doing this? This is a chance for us to deliberately bring a lot of context and information to some of the key things moving forward. A little bit of talk about our finances, talk about the land, some of the exciting news that we have that we've been wrestling through, and a story that I am not going to share today, but I have learned something, a local missional opportunity that Chantel has brought to us. Can't believe it, but you don't want to miss that. I'm exercising good discipline. It's like amazing. Netflix, David, you leave a little bit to the next episode.
Nice. I like what you've done there. Also then on the Saturday, we're doing a leadership development day. So this is, again, a lot of things going on. A lot of people lead and help us lead vision at Westside from different departments, different groups, and of course on then our house churches as well. So we're taking the sort of 9 till 3 slot on the Saturday and going to really invest in a kind of culture of leadership, leadership values. Because it's not just, like, pretty much one of the things we're blessed with at Westside is a huge community of really capable leaders. But of course, how do we lead at Westside? It's not just can we lead, but can we lead according to our culture and values and vision. And to us, that's really, really important. So a great day of investment going on there.
And apparently, it's an Irish person coming again.
Yeah,
is that the only people that can speak about gospel is just Irish?
I am bringing in a really good friend of mine, Dr. John Andrews, is coming in for that whole weekend. Yeah. So he'll be teaching Sunday morning as well. I have said to him, I said, listen, I'm a little worried that that people think I only have Irish friends. But John is world class. In fact, actually, Andy, when he was here in October, like Andy said to me on many occasions, like Andy used to use John in various different contexts, and I've worked alongside John. And he is just one of the most insightful leaders on how we lead according to our values, and also how we lead through pain and suffering and brokenness, which he's profound on. Yeah. So John's input across all those three sessions on the weekend is going to be, I would say, unmissable. So you can register for that on with the details are on the screen just there. There's a small charge for the Saturday. It's just $20, but we really would love to have you registered for whatever event it is that you're coming through, just so that we can plan numbers for that.
Awesome.
And then, Bobby, let's just talk a little bit about mission for a few more. The third of our big three: evangelism, discipleship, and then mission.
Well, I'll leave you one story. I think one of the coolest parts about you as Westsiders, and I hope it's always going to be told about us, is this unique journey. And the reason we love the Well story, this is a great example of it. Bumped into Westsider a couple of years ago, John and Betty, beautiful couple. They're here, they're retired. And we're having a coffee conversation, and it led into the storyline of, hey, how did you connect to Westside? He goes, now that's a really cool story. He said, we weren't doing gospel, we weren't doing faith, we weren't doing church. And we had a guest coming over, so they don't have children of their own, so they're always caring for people everywhere. Yeah. So they said they had a young girl student coming over to live with them for a season of time, and she had a checklist given to them of here's what I have to have. And one of the things on the checklist was she is a church person. So she said, I need to have a church. So he goes, I just had to start researching. So I jumped online, started researching, found Westside.
Yeah,
so
that's because our IT people, they ensure that if you search for pretty much anything in Calgary, the Westside King's Church is the first thing that comes up on Google.
I thought there was a God gospel thing going on.
God and IT.
God and IT. Okay, I like that. That helps a lot. So they brought you here for a Sunday, and they've never left. This has been their church for over 15 years. Now, the cool thing is, in hearing this story, he also has this missional call in his life that is absolutely profound. So he's been developing and working with, there's a big, large piece of land. They've used that to do the gardens that feed the food bank in town. And then Betty started jumping into a group called Elements a few years ago, where she does baskets for people. And this year, we help participate and help be a part of that. And just amazing to watch this storyline of from zero, a well-experienced, to suddenly now a missional part of just how they live, and now bringing other people into that. Yeah.
And I think that, you know, so the woman comes to Jesus, or rather, she comes for water. So, you know, an everyday moment, you know, Jesus navigates a kind of awkward situation with truth and grace and safety, you know. And the net result is, I love that line when she goes back and says, come back and meet someone who told me everything I ever did. He could be the Messiah. Yeah. This woman's everyday interaction, she leaves with purpose. She leaves with a sense of mission. You know, you read the story on, you know, she brings the whole village out to come and see Jesus. And that sense of the you that you talk about. Yeah. She doesn't, you know, become somebody that just stays with Jesus' own kind of little group, but she heads off back and does this incredible sort of missional things. And I just find that's a beautiful thing. I want to introduce someone to everybody just now. We have just recently, in the last few months, this is our first opportunity to have him come up. This is Stefan Brochu, who's looking after our global missions. So why don't you welcome Stefan just as he comes up. Come stand here, Stefan. It's great to see you. We decided to stand because I lost the bet about where Stefan was going to sit, and I didn't want him sat on my knee. So Stefan's a fantastic member of Westside, an incredible story, you know, just throughout his life, and it's just really great to have you on the team with us and looking after our global missions. So welcome, and everybody see you and get to know you a little bit. And tell us a little bit about, so, you know, we're talking obviously this morning about mission as one of the three big things that we want to be kind of committed to as a community. You know, and oftentimes mission has a lot of thoughts, and we do a lot of great local mission, and Bobby's going to talk a little bit about that at our community weekend. But if I'm sat here this morning and I'm thinking, okay, why have we got a global mission coordinator, and why should I be interested in that, and how can I be involved, how can I help? What would you say to us?
Well, there's a couple ways you could be involved. So we have three main partners that we're working with at this time. One's Hands at Work in Africa, and they work with community development in the poorest communities in Africa. Mm-hmm. The second one we have is in Southeast Asia, and they're working with women coming out of sex trafficking. They do some neat initiatives with like having a coffee shop that gets them in the community and also helps support the program. So we're working with them. And then the third one is with Homes of Hope. So that's building houses. Mostly one of our large partners is in El Salvador, and we've built throughout Mexico and Costa Rica. Yeah. And El Salvador also has a feeding program. So there would be three different ways of getting involved with them or with our partners, and that on the highest level would be taking a trip, and we'll hear from some people shortly that are going for a year to Africa. So we could do a short-term trip. We do a few of those every year. And then another way would be partnering locally with some of the different fundraisers we do. We have a bottle bin outside in the parking lot that raises money for the feeding program, and we do other local fundraisers that people could get involved as a volunteer or just participating that way. And then the third way is through prayer. So we have started meeting the second Sunday of every month up in between the services up in the offices. And if you'd like to come and be a part of praying for our global partners, or doing that on your own would be a great way. So those are three different ways you could partner.
Well, that's fantastic, Stefan. Thank you for that. From the very kind of simple and everyday right through to the investment. Now, I just want to ask a question there. You made a comment just then. You said some people are involved in kind of, you could get involved in a short-term trip. We've got some people going for a year. Okay. Yeah. We do short-term trips that are shorter than a year, right?
Yes.
Okay, that might be worth just clarifying, because, you know, somebody was there thinking, well, I could do a short term, maybe not. But let's talk, actually. So Ian and Bree and Brandon are heading on a one-year trip at the minute. Tell us a little bit about that as they come up, because they're with us this morning.
So they've all been part of a trip, like a short term, so a few weeks to Africa, I think in the last 2 years. And all three of them, when they were there, felt the call to come back for a longer period of time. So they're heading out in a week and a half. They are heading out for all on a 1 year commitment, and 1 year, maybe more. And so we were happy to pray for them this morning.
Yeah.
And they'll be working with Hands at Work Africa, which is working, like I said earlier, with the community developments in some of our poorest.
That's fun. And it's just an honor to have you with us this morning, and just such an outrageously exciting moment of your life. I love Stefan. This is a guy that understands something of how God works when he won't completely commit you to just a year. They're going for a year, and I heard it, maybe more. You know, but it's something about when God catches your heart, right? That you head out just for a short thing, God does something revolutionary in you, and you know, and then here you are heading off out for a year. So we want to pray for you a little bit. Bobby, do you want to say anything just now?
Westside, I just want you to see this. You know, Dave and I love talking about this, but we want you to visually see it. It was 9 years ago, 9.5 years ago, that Steph walked into a well experience, and God absolutely transformed his life. Many of you are here this morning. He's got a lot of great friends here. You've been part of the journey in his life. And man, if you've ever gone building with him in any of these homes, please understand he does the work of no less than five at a time. He's an incredible, talented man. Now a wonderful husband, and see how God is working in your life, and then we just keep moving through. This is what God does. These are well experiences. At some point in time in each of their lives, mom and dad joining us for their son today, this is a moment where God has transformed their heart because of a conversation, a moment with Jesus, and here we are. So we're honored that you can pray, because this is what God's been doing in you over your ministry, the things that you have seen. And did you hear what he said this morning? We're praying weekly, and we're joining together bi-weekly to pray for our missional partners. Yeah. That's what it's all about. Thanks for your leadership, Steph.
Beautiful. And then just before we pray for you amazing people just now, also let me throw a picture up on the screen. So we have a team going out to Southeast Asia.
Yes. Yeah, they're heading out February 18th till March 3rd, and there's eight of them there, and they are going to be going, working with our partner in Southeast Asia. They're going to be doing a build project on one of the farms that we work with, and also just building relationship, coming alongside the local team there to work with the women that are being like in the healing time after their experience.
So. Yeah. Well, so listen, Stefan, could you lead us in prayer? Pray for this amazing group of people here, that amazing group that are just on the screen at the moment, and let's just do that.
Dear Heavenly Father, we just come to you now, and we just thank you for all that you've blessed us with, and for these different opportunities that we have to serve you locally and around the globe. And we thank you for Brian and Ian and Brandon as they head out for the next year, and we thank you that you've provided the opportunity for them to go, and that they've listened to the call. And we just pray for provision, for protection for them, and for peace while they're over there, and that they would not feel alone, that they would know that we're here supporting them from Canada, and that that they would just be able to do your will and accomplish everything that you have for them. We also lift up the team going to Southeast Asia, and we pray again for protection for them and provision, and if there's any fear, anxiety, heading on such a long trip, that we pray that they would be filled with peace, and that they would also know that you are with them, and that you won't leave or forsake us. And we just thank you. Amen.
Well, hey, listen, we just want to just bless you guys, and just, you know, we honor the decision that you've made. We're here praying for you. Please know that. Reach out to us, you know, when you need more prayer, or let us know how things are. Keep us up to date. Stefan, I'm sure we'll keep you up to date with how things are for you. But thank you so much for such a brave and gospel-centered step that you're making. And then for all of us this morning, our thought is simply this, to say that may we, as God's people, find our well moments. Some well moments take us to Africa, some to, you know, Southeast Asia, some move us into new missions roles that we perhaps didn't see coming. But there's always those moments and those opportunities where you realize that God is just bringing us and guiding us and shaping us. So may you find that to be true in your own life also. And may God's grace and peace be with you this week. God bless. darkness fades into new beginnings.